Tim's a good singer.
If I start singing Where Is Love Now?
You need to learn the lyrics for next time, Tim, because we're not taking any shit.
Okay, welcome everybody, all the people on this watching here in the UK and different countries. We are having a live panel session tonight. We've got people from Mobilise Peace and Scientist Rebellion. We've got Zack Lumley, Orla Murphy, Dr. Tim Hewlett, and recently released from jail, Ronan Browne. So just before we start the panel discussion, I'm just going to play a short video, and very XOR style. It's all been very last minute, and the only way I can do this is by sharing my screen and then having to jump onto my other screen. So just bear with me for one moment and you'll get an idea of what these guys have been up to and why it's vitally important that we listen to what they say. And...
...to know, have the duty to act.
This is part of the Mobilise Peace campaign. We're calling on universities across Ireland and the UK and eventually internationally to act on the climate emergency.
Science has been crystal clear for a long time that we need to rapidly alter society in a deep way. I have printed two scientific papers, and one of them, some of the authors of that paper are at UCL, that's why I chose it. It's an analysis of the Arctic, and the conclusion is it's much worse than we thought. The other paper is by Erica Chenoweth. Her research has shown that civil disobedience or non-violent uprisings are twice as effective as violent uprisings.
The Oxford Merchant School's job is to research humanity's most pressing issues. They know that without changing our food system, we will not meet the Paris Agreement's targets. They know that civil resistance and non-violent direct action is the most effective way to rapidly transform a society.
If the universities of the world could only muster up the decency to act upon the truth that they've known for a long, long time, we could have peaceful, practical, positive and powerful change within a short period of time.
The universities are hand in glove with the system that's killing us, and they need to advocate for what the science demands, and the science demands that everything changes and that we decarbonize like it's an emergency, like our lives depend on it, and that's not what the universities are doing, and that is what we're highlighting today.
There you go. Thank you for that video. That video was made by Real Media. So shout out. They make quite a lot of XOR and environmental videos.
We take a look at the last 4 years of a president who was
so
never
just
far
bear
away.
With me one moment. I've got something in autoplay going on here. That was autoplay with a Jonathan, somebody coming in the background there. We're going to kick off. And so, Tim, you're an active scientist, and you're going to give us a rundown of some very scary stuff we were talking about earlier about the ecological and climate emergency and where we're at, and building the picture of why universities and educators are failing us in society and why they need to act, and also why Mobilise Peace has come into existence and Scientist Rebellion. So Tim, over to you.
Thanks, Virgil. I just want to provide some context to the discussion that's about to happen. I think most people want to hear about the personal stories, so I'll just be very, very brief. We all know that emissions are still rising, that ecosystems are being annihilated. But I think one thing that I really want to communicate is that there's a domino effect of climate tipping points that threatens to push the Earth into a state that is inhospitable to human civilization. And that is an irreversible process. So to give an example, you know, as the polar ice melts, that means that the seas and lands beneath are exposed and they absorb more solar energy than the ice does. The ice reflects some of it away. So that inevitably causes the Earth to heat up. Now, it's a natural process, regardless of what humans are doing in terms of emitting more carbon dioxide. And it will probably heat the Earth by about 0.4 degrees centigrade. Now, the nature of tipping points is that one failure can very well trigger other parts of the environment to break down. So for example, that melting ice might lead to the thawing of the permafrost, which contains about enough methane to raise global temperatures by about 2 degrees. That can push other accelerated processes like the burning of the forests or the peatlands, et cetera, with all of these mechanisms reinforcing each other. Now, crucially, it's thought that these processes are probably triggered somewhere between about 1 to 3 degrees of warming, and we're already beyond 1 degree. So if we don't transform this system immediately, there's a risk that we will be unable to stop an apocalypse. So even just 2 or 3 degrees of warming, which we are well on course to exceed, and the exceeding of which feedbacks may make unavoidable, that likely means massive agricultural failures leading to mass starvation and hunger. It means unprecedented drought and the desiccation of humans. It means an inundation for hundreds of millions of people by rising seas. It means natural disasters escalating year on year and billions of people, thousands of millions of people killed and forced to flee their homes. It means social collapse and the unleashing of humanity's inhumanity that goes along with that. Now, it's abundantly clear that the primary causes of this are a failed economic model predicated on a fantasy of endless growth and facilitated by a political system that is servile to oligarchic corporate power. When people say this system is unsustainable, by definition, that means that it must end. Now, the stark choice before us is whether it will end because we bring it to an end through political activity, through resistance, or whether it will end via system collapse with the social murder of billions of people. So it's the choices made in the next few years that will likely determine whether or not organized human life continues. In that context, we can't sit around and wait for somebody else to sort this out. We have to demand change with voice and body. That seems like an appropriate segue, so I'll pass straight on to, so that we can hear about Ronan's story of resistance and how he was punished for that courageous moral act, and from the others as well, and about the Mobilise Peace campaign. That was really just to contextualize the actions.
Thanks, Tim. That was a real punch to the gut. But yeah, an important reminder of why we do what we do. My name is Ronan. I guess my primary contribution to the environmental movement is to try and give closure on the economics of what have brought us here and that are preventing us from doing anything meaningful on climate. I co-founded an initiative called Mobilise Peace, which aims to mobilise universities here and around the world in peaceful civil disobedience to protect and regenerate life on Earth from the system that is destroying it. I'm just going to outline first off, before I talk about the actions that I took and the experience in prison, some of those fundamentals of economics, because I think even in XR we need closure on, yes, the science is clear, but the economics are clear as well, that this system cannot functionally do what we need it to do. Before that, I'll clarify that we're aiming for citizens' assemblies on the topic of system change to highlight and deliberate the alternatives that do exist. So some of those economic principles. So everything we do destroys the planet: construction, mining, travel, transport, forestry, fast fashion, manufacturing, electricity generation, heating, animal agriculture, non-essential monoculture farming, the service industries that rely on all of these, which is most services. So essentially, every day, 7 billion odd people wake up and get destroying the environment. And all the while, we need to heal it thoroughly and fast in order to have any chance. Number two, Debt and landlordism are two of the greatest threats to life on Earth, because they force people into things that they shouldn't be doing, or in amounts that they shouldn't be doing. Our economic system is intrinsically violent. It necessitates climate violences, ecological violences, social, economic, and racial violences. The wealth of the world in existence today, in the eyes of the neoliberalists, has been accrued by screwing people over directly or indirectly, immediately or in a longitudinal sense. People and animals and plants, I should include. You cannot have this system and a just transition, because this system is premised upon injustice. Injustice is the oil that lubricates the gears of this system. You can't have this system and meaningful climate action, because it necessitates the destruction of the planet by design. My background at undergrad level is in commerce and economics, and at master's level, I was just finished with the first years of my master's in education before I woke up to this reality. But just in case my credentials are insufficient, about 2 or 3 months ago, there was a letter signed by 100 economists from a number of the world's most prestigious universities calling for an end to the carbon economy, not just a degrowth, an end to the carbon economy, calling it fundamentally incompatible with a stable future. To understand how we got here and why we will not have meaningful action within this system, you have to understand how economic collapse works. So the global economy is like a house of cards. If you pull even just one major industry or large business from this house of cards, it's enough to collapse a whole global economy and bring about social disarray through economic disarray. Number six, you cannot extricate one economy from the global economy at once to have any chance. For humanity, in every sense of the words, we need to bring about a collective bringing to rest of this system by peaceful means and for peaceful ends. And we in the Mobilised Peace campaign, and I think in Scientists' Rebellion, we agree that this needs to come from universities, because we don't believe it is coming in as timely a manner as can be from anywhere else. You know, we'll hold out a little bit of hope for them, but we won't be waiting around for anything else to happen. Just give us a second. Oh yeah, sorry. And last but not least, thankfully, our global economy and this money system is a human-made abstraction that can be brought to rest by humans to make way for a lot of the genuinely exciting alternatives that do begin. And I say exciting at a background of the horrors that we do face, of course. About 6 months ago, after months of trying the acceptable methods of trying to mobilize or bring about a sane and humane and proportionate change, we essentially realized that we're going to need to start taking direct action against the university, Trinity College in Dublin, to begin with. We wrote to the senior management of the university, you know, in a respectful and collegial manner, outlining the science, outlining the economics, outlining the theory of social change. All answers to date have just been completely inadequate or disproportionate to the reality of what we're facing, and more immediately, of course, the horrors being faced in the global south. We decided to start taking direct action. We're calling for emergency assemblies within the universities here, there, and everywhere around the world, in which we outline the climate and ecological reality, the economic reality, the disproportionate effects being felt by the global south, the essential tenets of effective nonviolent civil disobedience, and have a referendum in the university thereafter on whether or not to mobilize the university in civil disobedience. We believe universities their inaction to date is criminally disproportionate to the horrors being suffered and about to be suffered, given the knowledges that they are bequeathed with in the sciences, in economics, in a range of fields, their disproportionate action we will not stand for. So started by in Dublin by spray painting the university with messages of saying Trinity knows, to mobilise peace, TCD, for TCD to break the vicious cycle, by bringing an end to this violent system, which perpetuates violences on a number of levels, most horrific levels, or in many horrific manners. So got arrested for that, and kept moving on from there. We then began actions at Oxford University and UCL, and Birmingham University at our next wave. But in the next wave in Dublin, because we still had continued failed or inadequate response from the university. You know, we keep giving them opportunities to be humane or to engage in a meaningful manner, but they are continuing to fail. So we decided we needed to up the ante, raise the temperature in a peaceful manner. We don't believe that arrests is enough. We believe it has to be prison, that the greater the sacrifice, the more powerful the action. We went again, I went again to the university and set off a fire alarm in the business school. The aim of that was to evacuate the campus and get them to the main square where I could give them a lesson in economics that I feel is absolutely crucial, that I feel the general public needs closure on. It was stymied in the moment. I handed myself into the guards after that, reached out to the university again, calling for a recorded online meeting, where we discussed the Mobilise Peace campaign in good faith and plan an emergency assembly and referendum for the university. They failed to respond again. So I started engaging in peaceful occupations in the office of the provost, who's kind of a senior most manager in the university. Completely peaceful, respectful of the staff and of what has already been faced, respectful of COVID social distancing. I went straight to the corner of the office with my mask on. I went peacefully when the authorities came to arrest me. Still no response by the university management in between, so I went back again. I wasn't arrested the first time. The security took me out. Then I went back again, got arrested the second time. Or sorry, they advised me the first time if I got arrested, or if I do it again, I get arrested. So I went back again. Got arrested after the third peaceful occupation. And took a break for a few days. Still no response from the university. So trespassed again with the intention of going to the provost office, and got caught on the way and got brought to, under arrest and brought to court. Had a second court case on the Monday where I was offered bail and I declined bail. The reasoning being, I believe that for me to accept the bail conditions, which required me to be off campus unless given permission from a staff member to be there, I believe that would make me effectively complicit with climate genocide, because I know they could just easily shut up shop and shut down the doors of their offices, which effectively shuts down the opportunity for me to protest peacefully. So I was brought to prison for not accepting the bail conditions. I was there for 2 weeks up until the 5th of January. From there, we had another hearing, another court case, and that was then pushed out. The hearing was pushed off for another 4 months. There could be a number of reasons for that, but it could be a strategic ploy on their part to kind of keep me away for 4 months while the senior management continues in their criminal negligence to the public who pay their salaries, who place their trust within the university to be acting within their interests. So I took the decision to temporarily take bail to once again reach out to the university management in good faith and give them another opportunity to for their, them to mitigate for their role in these multiplicitous and most heinous atrocities against humanity and nature. And they may well decline or refuse to act, act humanely or proportionately again, but we will we will take a decision from there after, depending on their response or lack thereof, on what to do next, without fear, in love, and in a manner that we believe will save as many lives as is humanly possible. I think Zach is going to talk a little bit about next wave or the rationale for the initiative and growing it, because it, again, it's crucial that we have a collective pressuring of governments through universities. And if it's not international, it'll fail. But if it is international, I believe it has enormous potential. Finally, just very quickly on the experience in jail. If I look exhausted, it's largely because, you know, we've done a lot of actions together. Overall, the experience was fine. You know, it could have been bad. I know some people's experiences there are bad, but effective civil disobedience, as Gandhi would say, has something to do with suffering cheerfully in prison. Regardless, my heart was smiling throughout. My body knew that I was doing the right thing. It has no, still has no doubt. I'd be happy to go back again if needs be, and quite probably will need be, just pick the right time for it. Yeah, hopefully raise the temperature in activist circles as well. We absolutely agree that hunger strikes, imprisonment, putting our bodies physically in harm's way, is absolutely crucial. That's everything on my front. Thanks for your time.
Thank you, Ronan, for that. And I was just worth mentioning just a couple of things that the guards in English are the police, and quite a few. I think Zack and Orla, you've both been arrested as well, doing direct actions in Dublin, and talking about the fact that you've got, like, it's different universities involved. So Zack, I know you're from Ireland, but you're actually a biology student from Oxford University. So you're part of Mobilise Peace and Scientist Rebellion. So if you'd like to just explain a bit more about Mobilise Peace and Scientist Rebellion, and what actions you're taking, and what actions also are happening in Oxford University and other UK universities.
Absolutely. Thank you very much, Fergal. So yeah, I guess I'll start out with the Mobilise Peace campaign, because that's kind of how I really got into activism in a proper way. So, you know, as Tim has made, you know, abundantly clear, our global climate and ecological systems are in a state of severe crisis. Governments worldwide have shown that they are either unwilling or will be too slow to make necessary changes. We, the environmental movement, have lobbied them for more than 40 years. But clearly that has catastrophically failed. As year on year on year, we've seen this rapid destruction of our remaining untouched habitats while emissions have rocketed. There's a new climate models are due to be published this year and predict as much as 5 degrees of heating by the end of the century. And as Tim, you know, outlined, global tipping point or global climate tipping points could be between 1 and 3 degrees. And through net zero targets aimed for 2050 and inordinately high per capita emissions, combined with raised border policies, our national and EU governments are essentially taking a trajectory that is consistent with climate genocide of the global south. So clearly there is a great injustice that is occurring, and there's a really strong reason to believe that policies, laws and lawful recourse to changing them will not work, as they have failed over the last 40 plus years. So that's kind of the logic behind why we need peaceful civil disobedience. It could be the best option and potentially the last option that we have. A key reason that we're focusing on universities and other academic institutions is that they're kind of uniquely positioned to mobilize into civil disobedience. So this is why the Mobilise Peace campaign and Scientists of Rebellion found a sort of natural affinity. I'll kind of outline those reasons now. So universities and academic institutions produce vast amounts of research on the climate and ecological crisis, right? They're the best place to understand it. Similarly, they're also experts in the economic system that has brought us to this precipice, the history of nonviolence, civil resistance, and oppression. And they also know the sociology of change. In addition to all of that, you know, knowledge and research, universities are often endowed with capital. They have large numbers of students, staff, both academic and non-academic, and alumni. And typically as well, they're located in regions with dense populations, typically cities and towns. So clearly they're expertly placed to mobilize. The Mobilise Peace campaign has three main aims, which Ronan kind of touched on. So the first is a recorded meeting with management. We took direct action against the university, and as Ronan said, we got completely inadequate responses and they would not even meet us for a recorded discussion. So we're planning to move on to the next stage, which is an academic assembly on the climate crisis. And we believe that if this people are given fair and unbiased information on this, then the logical conclusion would be to mobilize into civil disobedience. So currently we're petitioning the university to run an assembly on the climate and ecological crisis. I'm not a big petitions person because it often feels like selectivism. And you know, but it's obvious that we're doing more than that based on Ronan's actions. But by petitioning, we're trying to just get those numbers to engage, you know, TCD Students Union and other groups. So I'll put a link to the petition in the comments after this, so you can sign it. But yeah, so we're currently petitioning for this assembly. So this assembly would be an academic assembly on the climate and ecological emergency. It would be kind of modeled on a citizens assembly. So students, academic staff, and non-academic staff would be selected by sortition from the university population. And as I mentioned earlier, it would show the extent of the climate and ecological crisis with the threat of tipping points, mass displacement, etc. But crucially also, it would include the economic mechanisms that Ronan referred to, and it would include the history, rationale, and essential techniques of effective nonviolent direct action as practiced by Gandhi, Martin Luther King, the suffragettes, and countless others. And in order for this to be as fair and unbiased as possible, speakers should be provided by both our campaign, but also by the university, with attendees choosing who they wish to hear more from, like in a typical citizens assembly. And then the policy resolutions from this assembly should be binding for the university. And if they fail to act on it, then we should, you know, use the findings on civil disobedience to pressure them to adopt them. So yeah, I guess that essentially kind of outlines the kind of finer details behind the theory of the Mobilise Peace campaign. One of the kind of key tactics that we've used in this initial mobilization event, in addition to the peaceful sit-ins slash occupations that Ronan has been doing, is postering. So at the video at the start, you saw Mike, who's one of the co-founders of Scientist Rebellion, had got two academic articles. One of them was produced by UCL itself. And we've repeated this at multiple locations. So for example, I did it at Oxford, and Scientist Rebellion have used it before, Nature. And the key point here is to get the research produced by the institution that clearly shows that it is an emergency and say, why are you not acting on it? You have literally told us that it is an emergency and you're doing nothing about it. So that's kind of one of the key tactics that we're using at the moment. And yeah, like I mentioned, Scientist Rebellion and Mobilise Peace find a natural affinity because, you know, we're targeting academics. Academics have done a massive amount for the climate movement. We would not have a climate movement without the science, but clearly we need to step up because warning people has not worked. It's failed for the last 40 plus years and we shouldn't expect it to for our warnings to suddenly be acted upon unless we step up into civil disobedience non-violently. So yeah, I guess hopefully that answers all the questions you had, Fergal.
Yeah, no, it's very powerful, really, really powerful, calling out academics and universities because, you know, from previous conversations I've had with you and Ronan and the extent of we've got these great, you know, places of education and yet they look at the past and they'll teach us about history and they'll teach us about geography and literature and yet they're not preparing people for what's actually going to come. And I was really touched when I heard about Ronan's story over Christmas, the fact you're spending Christmas in jail for refusing bail. And I followed up all your posts that you had on Facebook. And I was shocked that Trinity refused to even meet. And I think, Zach, you mentioned the fact that one of the conversations that they had, they just mentioned recycling as opposed to, you know what I mean? And it's, you know, we got to the stage where like 40 years ago, we knew ExxonMobil knew about the climate crisis because they actually paid academics who are scientists and engineers to do these studies. So the academic community has known for 40 years and we can blame the oil companies and the gas companies, but they're, you know, they're in a business to produce money, but the academics are the ones who are producing these papers. And up until very recently, we've been battling even trying to convince people that there is a ecological and climate emergency despite all the science and despite what Tim is talking about, you know. So I'm just going to move over to Orla, who's hear a little bit more about your arrests and youth activism and your recent experience of your 15 seconds of legal advice. So, Orla, do you want to just introduce yourself and say a little bit more about how you fit into everything here?
Over to you. Hi, I'm Orla. I'm 19. I'm from Cork, which is in the south of Ireland. And so I had my first arrest and my first experience with the law on the 4th of December. So I went up to Dublin to do some actions with Ronan as part of the Mobilise Peace campaign. I went up, I suppose to explain a bit background, I've been involved in more of the youth climate side of things than the lads, even though I'm only a year younger than Zach. So it was a lot of like online kind of stuff. And I saw the amount of passion and there was no shortage of like caring in that movement or by anything. But there was a lack of impact, I felt, especially during COVID, things had gone a lot more online and it wasn't really working. So I came across Ronan and the idea of targeting university seemed like a really cool idea to me. So anyway, I kind of got a bit, I came to the conclusion that arrestable actions are the way to go. And I decided to go up to Dublin to participate in them. So the first thing we did was we did one of the pasting actions that Zach was talking about. So we got papers from Trinity College. I got them printed off and then brought them up to Dublin with me. And we pasted them onto the front of the Science Gallery, which is owned by Trinity College, as kind of a not-so-legal public exhibition on the front of the building. So we put them up with weave paste, and I think about two students saw them as they passed. It wasn't very early, but it's not a very busy area anyway. And I thought weave paste was a lot stickier than it is. So because of my first time using it, we made it ourselves and stuff, and the security guard came out and he made some comment and just kind of laughed, and he just tore it down like 2 seconds, and the amount of effort that had gone into getting those posters up there, and on the way, because we walked from the accommodation to the centre of town, which was a long enough walk, 20 minutes-ish, I was fairly nervous. So in my head I was thinking about, like, I did a podcast for FFF Digital interviewing an activist from the Philippines called Mitzi Janelle, and they had four typhoons in 3 weeks there, and she's from Manila, and they had three like stories of like building stories of flooding there, and they're the second most climate vulnerable country in the world, yet they emit 0.4% of emissions. So I was thinking of that, and I was thinking of the Ogoni 9 and all this injustice, and I was like, this is why you're doing this. And then just to see the guard like rip it down, I was like, this is not proportionate in any way. So I was walking around Dublin and I saw the Sustainable Development Goals. They are plastered up on the side of the Department of Agriculture, by the Department of Agriculture, on these lovely light up signs. And I got very angry when I saw them, because those goals were created by academics. So it's kind of attached to our campaign too. To show us how we can develop in a way that is sustainable, so we're not going to see 4 typhoons in 3 weeks in the Philippines, and so that we're not going to see loads and loads of people die, and they're already dying in the global south, so we're not going to see that suffering. And not only are the government not doing that, they have the absolute cheek to put those up and show them like they're a promotional tool, saying, look at us, aren't we great, we know what the UN says, yet they're doing nothing about it. And I just felt absolutely outraged and disgusted for every single person that I know of and the people that I don't know of and everyone in the global south. I just felt absolutely disgusted by it. And I don't know how in anyone's right mind they said, oh, this was a good idea, let's put them up. But it's not something that we should be surprised about, because it's happening time and time again. So they say all the right things. They look at the reports, they say, we made this report, look at this great report, and they use academics to do that. They use academic papers to create these recommendations so they can plaster them up on their buildings and do nothing about them. And academics are complicit in that, because they know that they will do that, because that was done time and time again. So academics must step up and say, look, we know, and they're not going to do anything if we just do our normal papers. We're in unprecedented times, like Tim has outlined. We're at the precipice of extinction of the human race. Like, that's where we're at. So I get that it's maybe not your job to go out there and get arrested or speak or do more public speaking or go out more than you are doing now. Maybe it's your job to just do your papers and give the recommendations to the government, but that's not enough. And you have to sit with yourself and say, is that enough for me? Am I okay with just, oh, I'll just do my job, even though I know it's not working, even though I know I could do more, even though I'm capable of doing more, even though I'm in a place of privilege, even though I know I am complicit in the exploitation and the death and suffering of other people, am I okay with that? And for me, even as a student with limited knowledge, but with enough knowledge to know better, I say, no, that's not enough for me. And so I did my action in Dublin. I spray painted "It's All for Show" on the Sustainable Development Goals on the Department of Agriculture, because there's no way you can argue that they are anything other than just a promotional tool for show. And I thought it was an absolute disgrace. So I wrote a sign that said, this is a disgrace. And I sat down on the ground and I waited to be arrested for it. I did it in spray paint, so not chalk paint, because I said that if the truth was real, if I believe that the truth is real, if I believe this enough to, then I wouldn't care if it was chalk paint or real paint, because why does it matter if I'm damaging public property, if all this is going to be underwater, if there's going to be like the scale of the events that we're going to see are in nowhere close to me damaging a little bit of property. And as well, to show on the back of my sign, I never got to show it, unfortunately, but I said, I get punished for spraying a little bit of paint, but corporations get what for polluting the planet and causing the suffering of millions of people. And that is the truth. They prefer to go after one individual like me than go after the real polluters and the real, like, why does one piece of government property is worth more than our all shared land and the lives of millions of people. So yeah, that's my little action that I did as part of it. And I think it just highlighted for me seeing those sustainable development goals, the fact that universities aren't doing enough, collecting knowledge isn't doing enough, creating recommendations isn't doing enough, going to class and learning for students as well isn't enough. We need to do more. And yeah, I believe that this campaign outlines the what more we can do.
Wow. It was very very powerful. Well done for everything that you've done. And as you said, like, you know, what difference does it make, chalk paint or real paint? You know, it's happening. And they got the audacity to come out and criticize you for that, considering I think Ireland is like the second country in the world to have declared an ecological and climate emergency behind the UK. Yet in terms of EU emissions, they're one of the highest per capita in Europe. And I think they're second highest for failing to meet their CO2 reduction targets. They're way off course. So absolutely right to be calling them out as a hypocrites, you know, 100%. So, you know, thank you for doing that, you know, and more people need to be calling them out and calling out the universities and academics. And we've got a comment from Lindsay in the chat there, and she's saying it's all whitewashing. The fact that, like, you've got academics writing on papers and they're able to kind of just whitewash it away. People flying all around the world to go to conferences for 2 days. You know, we're going to have 16,000 people, I think it's coming, delegates coming from all over the world for the climate change negotiations in Glasgow. You know, so a lot of these are all academics and the people who spend a lot of money and high carbon are educated people. And it's something that's, you know, hasn't been addressed. And I think brilliant what you're doing. This academic assembly is a fantastic idea. And it's a really good goal. So it's Mobilise Peace working with the scientists rebellion to get this off the ground. I'm just gonna ask Tim, from a scientific point of view, you're an actual, are you a scientist or what's your actual background?
My background's in astrophysics.
Astrophysics.
I'm a postdoctoral researcher.
Yeah, so you're pretty good at crunching numbers and you've got a pretty good idea what's going on. So from an academic point of view, how have you engaged with your fellow colleagues on the lack of action from universities? And also what university did you go to?
I got my PhD at the University of St. Andrews. I'm a researcher now at a university in Chile, working remotely.
Yeah. And the engagement with fellow, you know, academics, and, you know, as I said, like, we've got all these research papers now coming in from, you know, climate scientists, and, you know, we've reached the stage where it's 99.9% are green. You got the kind of 0.1 who get paid from an oil and gas company who disagree. But so the fact is, like, we've got this consensus going on, and surely if you know that, and we are the kind of the, It's like going to the fire. The first people there is the fire engine, which is the academics, and they know what's going on. So surely all of them should be like screaming about this. You know, what kind of response are you getting from the academic community?
Well, I think, you know, it's partly like you said, that those who are the most educated often and have the most privilege are the least willing to do something about it, is often the case. And I think scientists and academics fall into that category. So even though we understand that the destruction of the capacity for life on Earth is occurring before our eyes, scientists are very happy to say, yeah, people should rebel, people should stand up to this, but they won't actually go out there and do it themselves often. So that's what we exist to do, is try to make that appeal directly to our colleagues, to say, no, you should be out here on the front lines. How can science be credible if you don't act like it's real? So we're finding some resonance with that. I think there are quite a lot of scientists who actually really want to do more, who understand that they have an obligation, but don't necessarily know how to make a difference personally, or just haven't been compelled in a personal direct way. there's this disconnect that I think loads of people have, and scientists aren't immune from it, that this disconnect between what is going to happen and your conception of your own status. So it's a problem faced by other people, and we need to bring that into the present so that people know, no, this isn't a problem of the future. It's not a problem of somebody else. This affects everyone on Earth, and everyone needs to be involved in disobeying this system that is causing genocide. So we're finding, we're starting to make progress, I think. I think when people are confronted by that reality, some will step up. And we're starting to organize internationally, coordinated actions amongst the scientific community. And I think you'll see in a couple of months' time, I think you'll see hundreds of scientists coming out in civil disobedience. So I think we're starting to see progress, but it's taken too long.
And where can more people get involved? Obviously you don't have to be a scientist to get involved. I know you put a link in the chat. There's a sign up information. So if people fill that in, they can get some more information of what to do. Also, you got your channels. So a bit of a shout out. What can people do?
You can find us Scientist Rebellion on Facebook. You can email us at scientistrebellion@protonmail.com. You can check out our website, scientistrebellion.org. Get in touch. We'll also be getting in touch with tens of thousands of scientists in the coming months directly. So if you are willing to join us, then great, and we will help you to do that.
Fantastic. And so with the people who haven't been fully through education yet, like Orla, I know you're setting out, and Zack, you're a second year student. You know, you've obviously got your fellow colleague students you can influence. And so people in your situation, I know Zack, you're in a university, and you can petition a university, you can take action there, also talk to your lecturers. So what kind of action then for activist students actually in university can take?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, everyone or the vast majority of people, if they are at a university, can get involved in some way. So if you message us, we can give you a lot of advice on how to plan a direct action. The kind of postering action is one that's very easy to do. And it's quite, I guess, low level, or it's a good, way to get into direct action for the first time. But then if if that doesn't work, or you don't get any sort of response, you could try something a bit more spicy, like throwing paint or something like that. But try and lobby your SU to get involved. And if things don't work, just try and set up an assembly yourself. And then if people say, oh, well, that's not valid, you say, well, okay, you set one up then, and we'll make a valid one. I'm not sure if that's a great answer to your question.
No, but absolutely. It's pushing it out in all different angles. Yeah.
If you message us, we can give you advice.
Yeah, no, great. And so Mobilise Peace and Scientist Rebellion, you've got a lot of literature that people can tap into and read and see what's going on and get involved. And Orla, I believe you're a film student. So I don't know if you're still active in your college with your, how are you getting on with your colleagues? Are you engaged with them?
Yeah, I'm a film student. I'm in a college of further education. So it's 2 years here. And then I am applying it through UCAS this year to go to for my final year. I've talked a lot with my colleagues, and especially after I got arrested, I went up to Dublin during college time, and we're in college at the moment because we're a practical course. So I told my lecturers, I'm making a documentary on all of this, and that was kind of the excuse I was given to go up. They didn't know I was going to participate in actions, though. So they'll see when they see the film, I guess. But so yeah, that people were, it was, I found it was a tool to open conversations, definitely. And I just come back to that thing that like it's all for show. I felt like just posting on social media or talking about it or whatever, it's great to open conversations. But I think when you start doing actions and putting yourself out there like that, you have the conversations have a different weight and people take it in a lot more. I think for people trying to start out, I know there's a lot of, like when I turned 18 first, I wasn't like, oh yes, like I'll get arrested now or anything like that. And not to say that people under 18 can't get arrested if they want to, they can do whatever they want. But it takes a lot of time to deal with this stuff and to think about it. For me, dealing with all this science and this really, really hard reality of kind of your own complicity as well as like the world and the system that we're in, it can be all fairly traumatizing, to be honest. Even if you're not impacted by it, and then if you're impacted by it, you already have all that going on, so it's very difficult to get up and do action. For me, action is what helps me deal with all that. And so I'd say it's a way to empower yourself and say, yes, you actually do have power in this. What the non-violent civil disobedience, which is what we're talking about here, what we all take part in, recognizes that your power in your society, the power that people have over you, is that you obey them. And so by being disobedient, that is your power. So you say, no, I'm not going to do that. I'm not going to obey. And so find an abuse of power. Now, our campaign is we're going for universities, but wherever you are, there's loads of them, believe me, and you know it. Find an abuse of power and find a way to disobey that. And do it in a way that, and find people around you. And if you can't find people around you, it's okay to do it yourself. And there's plenty of us out here through the internet, is great to connect and support you if you can't find anyone in your locality, because I couldn't. And so know that you're not alone, and know that any action that you take is, what, even if you don't feel that it's as big as what anyone else is doing, don't even think about that. Just do what you can do right now. Do your best. And that's all we can do. And just act as if the truth is real. Educate yourself, educate those around you, and try and do actions when you feel like you can. And even when you feel like you can't, be secure in the knowledge that like you're doing the right thing. And it's really important that we all try our best. And that's what,
well, you've motivated me, right? That's it. That's great. No, really, you know, look, really powerful stuff, you know, and this is truly amazing and inspirational. And you're right, it's not going to go away. Everybody needs to get involved, and what you guys are doing, really pushing the front on questioning the educators and the educational establishment is absolutely fantastic. And we definitely need a lot more of this, and we need people, academics, to start stepping up and doing what they can. And I've been in that scenario of my work, by doing this it probably affects me, you know, getting jobs, but like, you know, fuck it. It's we've got our own different ways of doing things, you know. So just to finish up, I'm gonna just go pass back to Ronan. He's had 2 weeks in over Christmas and inside in jail. Just wanted to ask, actually, before we finish up, what was the actual experience like of actually being in the cell, and you know, just how was it, really?
I'm not gonna lie, it really was fine. Like I'm aware that for some people it could be an incredibly traumatic experience. It wasn't. Maybe I was lucky to some degree. I have learned some incredibly powerful meditation techniques that helped me through that experience and many others. I might post a video on the Mobilise Peace page in case it's useful. It's been incredibly useful for me, or helpful to anyone. Honestly, it was fine. Like if I'm being honest, we spent a lot of the day, playing cards and listening to RTE Gold. but don't get me wrong, I'm aware it can be incredibly traumatic for other people. But But again, the I think now don't get me wrong, XR has cured my depression of the state of the world. But I think with a little bit of room to grow, that like the more you probably don't really want to do it, it's probable the more powerful the action will be. Like that's the whole point of sacrifice. And that's what moves me when I see other people do it, or do things that they don't want to do for other people. It kind of follows the principle of planting a tree that you might never get to sit under. And we need to start planting lots of trees, I understand. I just want to finish up one or two other points, if I may. I understand some people might have some concern about targeting universities. Now, I want to make it clear that like as a trainee educator on leave, now I hold education as sacrosanct as well. I'm sure the others do. Like, that's kind of why we're doing what we're doing, because it's a question of what that we should be educating in as a matter of utmost priority. And there's going to need to be a peaceful resistance across Earth, I believe, if we're going to have any chance. Sorry, I lost my train of thought there. I think anyone who might be kind of like a little bit internally resistant in that sense, should know that what we are calling for isn't as a replacement to education, it's as a complement, and to keep solemnly in your heart and mind of what is already happening in the global south, and the fact that there are no doctors on a dead planet, no engineers, no accountants, no scientists, you know, no writers or whatever, you know, we've lost the world, we need to win it back from the grips of those destroying it before we can have any chance of or before there's any chance that our, which is the best of my read, of having a future that we're studying for, or that what we're studying for can actually be put into good use. Win back the future first. So you keep studying by all means as well. You absolutely do not just have to be a scientist for this as well. We believe the economists, the accountants, the finance lecturers as well, all academics, and students engaging in civil disobedience, I think it will help sweep the legs from what is both a practically and morally illegitimate economic system here, there, and everywhere around the world. There's enormous power in scientists engaging in civil disobedience, but I think the high priests of economics or whatever also need to be acting as well, because far too often, whenever it comes to talks about proportionate or humane scale and urgency of action, too often the answer is, oh, but the economy, oh, but jobs. The economists need to show with their bodies as well, no, fuck that. And there are alternatives, they're not being listened to. I believe it's absolutely their duty, because those answers aren't going to come through media or government, because media is beholden to advertisements. So if you're a student, if you're an academic, if you're a graduate, if you're a concerned citizen in the vicinity of the university or the university, please get involved with us. We need you. I think you need you also. Thanks again, everyone, for your time. Pleasure.
There we go. Thank you. Thank you, Ronan, for that. And just a reminder to anybody who's watching this, the very least you can do is please share. We need to get this message out. The mainstream media are failing us. They're not talking about the ecological and climate emergency. They're not giving it the same urgency that they're giving the health crisis that we're living through now. So we're asking people to please share and please get into conversations with friends, family, anybody about this. And we need to get pushing on all fronts. So behalf of everybody here, I'd just like to thank you for watching. I'd like to thank Orla, Tim, Ronan and Zach for tonight. And we're talking about having a follow-up conversation next week or the week after. So stay tuned. Okay. Thanks, everybody. Hope to speak to you soon. Take care.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Bye. Thank you.